chocolates, malt, candy, gumdrops, anything you want. You've come to the right man because I'm the candy man.
These are two theater candy machines from the turn of the century, early 1900s. A lot of painted coin acceptors and plates that all need to be replated. This door has been broken, so we'll have to put it back together before refinishing. The coin mechs are coming completely apart. We still have all of these to take apart. And here's all the pieces after they're disassembled. Everything in here has got to be completely cleaned. Repair any damaged pieces. And then we'll send these front plates out to be re-nickel plated, and also these handles. Down here, this whole door is missing. This is for storage of extra candy underneath. So we'll be replicating that. Four sheets, a little over $1,000 for that veneer. And that will replace the existing veneer. We've got huge chunks missing out of the cabinet in many places. And some pretty bad veneer cracks, so it's all going to come off. All this extra electrical stuff is all add-on that doesn't belong, so that'll all have to come off. Alright, this is how we take off the old veneer. After removing all the veneer, I discovered that in some cases the veneer was the only thing holding the cabinet together. This was originally glued with horsehide glue, but as soon as I removed the veneer, these pieces just fell away. So I will drill and screw these back in addition to gluing them, so we have a good sturdy cabinet before we re-veneer.
When you know all the words to the songs,
what you doing here, bud?
Cleaning things, the gas, the brush.
Uh-oh. Clean it up.
This is what they mean when they say, sock it to me.
Nice butt.
Like it?
Mom does.
Good
tea ever.
And yo, I need you. Sunday dress will be rain.
Here's all the parts to the coin mechanisms. They're all cleaned up, ready to put back together. Here's my makeshift paint booth.
Oompa, loompa, doopa-dee-dee. If you are wise, you'll listen to me.
What do you get when you guzzle down sweet?
Eating as much as an elephant eats.
What are you at, getting terribly fat?
What do you think will come of that?
We're going to put back together a coin mechanism, starting with the empty plate, putting in four screws that are half inch long. These are 8/32s, four of them here, and the longer one, 3/4 inch here at the bottom. On these two pieces, you can see that I have one notch that's up higher and one notch down lower. The lower notch goes on this side, and the notch that's higher goes up here on this side. These discs come in different size openings for the right denomination of coin to fit in. This is a nickel, and a penny one has a smaller slot in it. This goes down with this little tang sticking off to the left and this little indent here on this side. This plate is used to hold the nickel. When you crank the handle, the nickel will fall here, and then as you turn the handle back, the nickel slides down and off. And that piece goes right down here, like so. This backing plate goes on next. And this bracket with the tab facing up goes over the top two screws. And then three nuts go on the top two and bottom screw, and a standoff on the middle two screws. Next to go in is a bar and a spring, a pivot point, and a couple screws. Assembled, it looks like this. The spring is right in there, curving up and around and back down, and that's applying spring force to this so that it can pivot up and down. And what that does is, without a nickel in, you turn the disc right here. This edge will drop in and catch that disc, so that's preventing you from rotating the handle farther and getting candy when you haven't put a coin in. So right there is stopping it. Now, when you put a nickel in, then the nickel, as you turn the disc, is going to push this indentation, goes through the other side. The nickel is going to push on that and pivot this outward. So as a nickel pushes on this, it lets this come forward and not be engaged, so I can turn past it and crank the handle all the way around. This screw right here and locking nut are to adjust the height of this. So it should drop down in, but then when the nickel's put inside, if it doesn't let this go past, if it's still locking up, you have to adjust this screw. Or likewise, if it'll turn all the way without putting a nickel in, then you have to adjust the screw in the opposite direction. The handle goes in next, and this cam is what attaches to this side. So they go on like this, and then there's a flat washer and a nut. Assembled, it looks like this. Then we have a lever with a shoulder screw for pivoting and spring. Once it's together, you can see the pivoting action, and that will pivot when the coin falls down here, and as you rotate back, you're riding on this brass piece that I showed you earlier, and it's pushing the coin against this to pivot it outwards. And that pivoting is going to move this lever, which will come into play later. Then you have a crescent-shaped piece with a tiny spring on it, and that goes right on top of this. You can see the spring in here, and that gives a little bit of force to keep it pushed out, and you're riding on this pin. Now we're going to set this aside for a minute and concentrate on another piece that has to go together. All these pieces are going to go on to here. When all together, you have this peg or finger that pushes down, and that translates through the underside up over here and works this lever. So when you push down on this, what you're really doing is retracting this tiny finger right there. And once this is assembled into the coin mechanism, when you rotate the handle and the nickel goes all around to the bottom and stops, if this finger is depressed, then this was pulled back out of the way and it lets the nickel drop. And that's important, because if the nickel is allowed to drop, then you can complete the cycle on the handle. But with this up, that indicates that you're out of product in that column. So this does not retract, it stays forward. And when you rotate the handle, the nickel goes all the way around and it rests on this and is not allowed to drop. So that when you turn the handle back, the nickel stays in and it doesn't vend the product, because there's nothing left in that column. So you don't lose your nickel. These two pieces go together in this fashion. There's a slot here that goes into this hole, and placed in this position, this orientation, bringing it together so that it looks like this. But this will come together as two different halves later on in the assembly. For right now, we're going to take half of that assembly and place it here on this hub, like so. So with this in place, we have this piece which goes over the top, and then the slot on here has to go into there, and with your handle at the at-rest position, like it's ready to accept a coin, This is facing downwards, the raised hump. And then this backing plate goes over the top. And you have to make sure that this protrusion, that tab, goes into the slot that's way down here in the bottom. That tang has to fit into that slot. And then there's four screws that hold it all together. Here the screws are in place and that tang is coming through the bottom. There is a spring that has to be placed on this side, and where it goes from and to is back on this cam. On the outside there's a spot to grab the spring. The other end of the spring goes onto this backing plate right back here onto that tang sticking out like that. And the purpose of that spring is to bring the handle back to an at-rest position ready to accept the coin. When there's product in the candy machine, it's stacked up and rests on this finger. So the finger is depressed when there's product there, the finger is up when there's no product. And the way this returns your coin is that when I rotate this, I will rotate that around, but without this finger being depressed, right in there is a small arm, that tab sticking up right above my finger. That needs to engage that next cam, but it doesn't. It slips and goes past it, and it allows this to just remain in the half cranked position and brings your nickel back out. But with this finger depressed, that will pull back that arm that you saw previously with the little tiny peg that sticks out in the way of the nickel chute or the coin chute where the nickel's going to fall. So with this depressed and with the little pin pulled back here, the nickel will drop down, and then as this starts to rotate back, right there, you drop in and engage this piece. That little tab sticking up engages that cam, which is driving this, and allows it to rotate back. Nickel drops out, and you finish your Vend cycle on that cam in the back. Now there's two more pieces left to go on, and then you can see how it's going to vend the product. This plate goes over here with these pins going towards the face of the mech. And then this bar engages in those pins sticking out. And then some special brass screws with a raised flat area for pivoting on go in here. This is the final assembly put all back together, and you can see the action of this bar being retracted when I crank the handle. And if there was no product left, finger pops up, and when I release and come back, it stays in that position, and that's where it will remain. And you won't be able to use this until you fill up the column with product. So when this pulls back and the product drops against his finger, it then allows the coin to drop and complete the cycle by pushing the product off this little ledge and out to vend it to you. So once again, a full cycle is crank back, let the next product fall in, and push it out. Here are the candy machines. Restoration has been completed. With this door swung open, take a look at the inside.
Lollipop, lollipop, oh, lolly, 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 lollipop, lollipop, oh, lolly, 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 lollipop, lollipop, oh, lolly, 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 lollipop.
The doors are completed that I had to make from scratch. Just some plywood glued two pieces together for strength. You can see the pattern in there. The only original remaining inlay left on the machines were these strips here that are in the upper middle door. So I bought some maple burl, and I found it surprisingly that with these machines being almost 100 years old, the same exact inlay was still available. So for the cache doors as well as for the lower storage doors, I stripped all this off and then had to put new figured mahogany on up to here, and that was with just regular contact cement, and then butt this up against, and then the burl, and then another strip of this, and just lay all these next to each other one at a time. I found all of these items inside the candy machines while I was restoring them. A couple empty signs, a weekly program from the Strand, including Abbott and Costello, who are going to be there in person, some railroad coupons, unused, and these machines came out of Canada, and here is a 1941 gift card that lets one adult get into the Odeon Theater in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Electrical rewiring has been completed. This is the new figured mahogany veneer. All panels re-nickel plated. So what I did here to rewire the electrical is added a switch box. You can turn the lights on or off. put some cable clamps and drilled holes through so that the cable isn't having to run up and over. Because the candy boxes come in all different shapes and sizes, you have to have some way to adjust the size of these racks that the candy stands in. The adjustability of the candy racks is achieved by all of these thumb screws along the top and bottom. This screw and nut is attached to the back plate of the rack, and it's long with a slot in it so that you can loosen this, put a slotted screwdriver in there, and you've got a long range of motion so you can put something as thin as a pack of gum in the rack or bring it all the way back to get a wide-sized box. And then these screws here are holding on to the side rails, the left and right hand rails. So you adjust these in and out for the width of your box. When your candy is vended from the stack, it falls against this curved metal and slides out to you. Both cabinets received 4 coats of Flecto Verathane SB60 semi-gloss. All of the nickel plating was done by Superior Chrome in San Jose, California, and all of the candy came from oldtimecandy.com on the internet. If you're going to change out the type of candy that's being vended, you open the door and take a flat blade screwdriver, unscrew these two, and lift up until they hit the large diameter holes so that it can lift out. And there you have the display that these boxes are just sitting on spikes. To collect the money, you open up this door. Then pull out this cash box. So all the nickels are just laying in there. For the two vends on the side, left and right hand side, you have to reach in and pull that cash box forward and out. So you have a smaller cash box that is for the two left and two right hand side columns. When you put this back in, you have to slide it all the way to the edge of the cabinet and then push it backwards. It falls back in about 3 or 4 inches. Now I removed all the candy from these boxes because in my candy machine I left the candy in, and after several years it melted and became a goopy mess soaking through the boxes. But rest assured, this candy won't go to waste. In this case, it's going to my waste. Just one of the many sacrifices that I have to make for my customers. Milk Duds and Red Hots. That's a combination. All of the keys have been put into a plastic bag and that's stapled to the top of the cabinet. Arnold, you will want to open up the lower storage door, and inside you're going to find all of the extra veneer and the inlay. These are the bulbs that I used, so there's a couple extra for you. All of the restoration receipts and invoice is in that envelope. When you unpack this machine, you're going to see this sticker on the front glass. And what that's referring to is around the back side, you will need to remove all three back doors, and down where the candy is, I've put blue tape going along the bottom of the candy box and up and here to hold it so it doesn't jiggle loose during shipping. So every one of those needs to have the tape removed, and then you should be able to start vending candy. But you've got 1, 2, 3 to take care of. All right, try to keep up as I build the shipping crate.
So sweet, you make my mouth water.
There are 1.5 foam panels to protect the machine on all sides, and double panel thickness up above. Panels are glued up here with contact cement. And this front face, as well as the face on the back, as you can see, they're going on last. The sides are already here. So these front panels are going to be adjustable and can vary in their depth. So if you do resell a machine, and you want to use the same crate to ship it, you can have just one machine standing in the middle and then take these front and back panels and move them in until they capture on both sides, and you'll be able to reuse this. To open up this crate, you'll want to get onto a ladder, look down into the top, and take off all of the screws around the perimeter from the top, and then the lid will lift off. The front and back panel come off next. You'll do that by removing all of the screws all the way down on each side, and then there are 5 screws across the bottom. When these come off, then you'll have just the one side and this other left, which are attached along the very bottom all the way along. You take those off and the panels will fall away. You'll be able to get the machines out and enjoy your can. Thanks for watching this video and have a great day.
For more information, visit GameRoomRepair.com.